listening to The Heidi Ruh Show, where you'll hear compelling stories from female leaders, creators, and innovators. Today, I have Allison Fillmore on the show with me. She is the executive director of the PGA Tour Tour Championship. Now, this is a huge deal because Allison is the first woman to ever hold that position in the Tour Championship. And her career, man, has she had a career. It has spanned a lot of different sports teams, from the Sacramento Kings, Atlanta Falcons, Atlanta Dream, Georgia Force, NASCAR, and of course, now PGA. But if you're like, Heidi, I'm not really into sports. Well, do not worry, because Allison shares how she's dealt with being in an industry where it's male-dominated. A lot of times she's the only female in the room. She also talks about how to balance family and work and lessons for anybody running a business or in a corporate environment, or even if you just work part-time. So I promise you there are some great nuggets in here, no matter where you are. But before we hear from Allison, I wanted to share a few things that really impacted me from this episode. The first one is Allison had mentioned something about listening, making sure we all listen without thinking about what we're going to say next, which is really tricky for me interviewing people for a podcast, because I'm constantly trying to make sure that I'm actively listening, but also that I'm thinking about how I can take this conversation kind of to the next level. How can I ask questions that give great pieces of wisdom and advice and stories to you that you can learn from? So that really kind of reminded me to make sure that I'm always doing that, not only on the podcast, but also in day-to-day life. We also talk about work-family balance, and Mike and I had recently talked about that with the studio. So now, I don't have kids, so this isn't a total, like, I'm not saying that this is an absolute comparison at all, but it has almost felt like we've birthed a child with opening the business, the voiceover studio business. And And so one of the things that we were talking about was, you know, it's great because it really bonds us even more. I mean, we every day we have to work together towards a common goal. But then I said, the problem could be is that what if in 5 years from now, I mean, hopefully not, but what if 5 years from now we're like, yeah, we either sell the business to someone else or we walk away or it doesn't succeed. Then is that going to kind of leave us feeling this void of like, whoa, what do we talk about now? How do we interact? How do we communicate without having this business? Which is probably the same thing for kids. That's what they talk about with when you are empty nesters. And so it just got us both kind of thinking that we need to be a little more conscious of trying to always find things even outside of the business that we enjoy together, which is a little hard. We're a little different. But it just kind of made us think a little bit deeper about that. Okay, and then the final thing is that we talk about calendars and how shared calendar has really saves the day. And that has worked for Mike and I, especially with the business. But I wanted to hear from you. I wanted to find out if there's things, and listen to the rest of the episode and you'll hear a little bit more about how we talk about it. But I want to hear if you have any tricks or tips on how to keep everything straight, whether you are trying to keep a family straight, whether you're just trying to keep straight between a roommate. I mean, you have to kind of compare schedules with a roommate. So if you have any suggestions or tips, you can just talk to us on social media, on the Facebook, on the podcast website. All the links are in the show notes, so you can find it there. So I'd love to hear your tips, and then I can share it with everyone else. Okay, so Allison, I want to start off by hearing a little bit more about your story. And I'm not even just talking about like the past 10 years or so, but your story really started pretty young when something major happened in your life and you lost someone that was really close to you. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how it led to where you are today?
Yeah, absolutely. When I was young, I was really focused on sports. I played, softball, basketball, volleyball, you name it, and actually picked up racquetball. Racquetball was a sport that I loved due to my mom. She taught me how to play. And when I was about to go to college, I lost my father, a massive heart attack at the age of 46.
Wow.
So I really changed kind of my thought process in terms of, you know, what I wanted to do with my life, what I wanted to be, how I wanted to, you know, be as a person, and you know, in terms of being, you know, a strong business person or a healthy person. You know, there's so many things that go through your mind when you lose a parent so young.
Sure.
So I really sat down and focused. I learned a lot from my dad. He started many companies and was a great entrepreneur. So, you know, the work ethic was there. So, you know, I really wanted to do something different. He was always in the tool and die industry. So my parents had these companies when I was younger. And
you tool and die, that means like tools that you use to, and then dye for like
dye
clothing.
Cut. Yeah.
Dye cut. Okay. Yeah. Got it. Okay.
So I ended up going to Ohio University for school. Their sports management program is one of the best. Entered there and really worked hard, tried to get as many internships as I possibly could. I think over winter break 1 year, I worked 3 jobs,
wow.
including an internship. So, you know, it was really important to me because we didn't have the money to put myself all through school. So paid a lot of myself through school and had a lot of loans when I got out. So I wanted to make sure to take care of all of those. I moved back home with my mom and really put, you know, really tried to focus on, you know, what I was doing with my life. Started with a company called Collegiate Directories. Felt that I could come out of school and make a ton more money. And I quit that job for another job. And
okay.
I got fired in 4 months.
Because goodness.
I wasn't passionate about what I was doing. I didn't love it. And that was my wake-up call. Again, just it was my chance to try something new. And I was like, you know what? I need to be passionate about what I do. I need to love what I do. Mm-hmm. So I started working for a minor league hockey team. And from there, my career has soared. I found what I love to do. I love talking to people. I love talking about sports. I love being involved in sports. And we sell fun. So it was really easy for me to, you know, move into this career. So from there, I went out to California. I worked for the Sacramento Kings for about a year and a half, came back to Atlanta and started with the Atlanta Falcons, was there for 5 years, moved on to the Atlanta Dream. I was the first employee there. And after a couple of years, the ownership group, unfortunately, was closing its doors and got a call from Atlanta Motor Speedway.
Wow.
Started there, was there for 8 years. And then in about April of 2017, I got a call from the PGA Tour and haven't looked back since.
Oh, my goodness.
It was fabulous.
Yeah, what a ride. That is so crazy. One of the things that you said is you said, it, you know, your father passing away, that really changed kind of your perspective on life.
Mm-hmm.
What do you feel like you were thinking before that happened? Like, where did you want to go? Or were you even thinking about that?
I wasn't thinking about it. I really didn't think. I just kind of thought, you know, I was young. I was 17. I didn't even think about what was next in my next chapter. Mm-hmm. And then when my father figure, the man that's always taken care of me throughout my life is gone, I had to really think about what's going to happen moving forward. Mm-hmm. You know, my mom was great, but she started working like 3 jobs to take care of us. So it was hard for me to and I'd never want that situation to happen to another human being ever again. So I started getting prepared. I started really thinking about what I was going to do with my life.
Hmm. What would you say to someone that maybe has lost a parent young or, you know, whether it's in their 40s or whenever, what do you feel like was the biggest thing that helped you grieve and heal through that process?
You know, I was really quiet. I didn't talk about it a lot at first. I found vocalizing my feelings helped quite a bit. So, you know, just talking to some friends about it really helped me heal a lot better. I still to this day don't talk about it a ton. My husband asks me questions all the time and I get kind of quiet about it, but, you know, talking to people does help, but also, you know, I'm spiritual.
Yeah.
I pray
yeah.
and, you know, praying helps me get through it as well.
Yeah.
So it's you never expect it. It's never something that you ever want to have happen to anybody. It's not something you can prepare for either.
Yeah.
So it's just, you know, taking you know, every moment and saying this could be my last and really in living in the moment, I would say is good advice.
Do you think that your father would be so proud of you?
I think he would be really happy.
Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah.
I think so too. So going into all of these different sports, mm-hmm. I mean, you've had to have faced some type of resistance being a woman.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So what were some times that you felt like either you weren't heard or you just felt that resistance because you were a woman?
Well, I had a position. I'm not going to go into who it was.
Okay.
but I was told that I would not be able to move up there because I didn't have the stamina or the drive to do it. So I turned around and said, okay, well, if that's how you feel about me, obviously I'm not, you know, I'm not looked at as someone that can move up. So I looked elsewhere. You know, I don't let it get to me a lot. I'm in a room with men, only men, majority of my career. And honestly, I enjoy it. It doesn't bother me in the slightest. I feel comfortable being able to interact with men about sports is a big topic, and
sure.
It's something that I can hold my own on and talk mm-hmm. and talk to people about. So it hasn't been, I don't let it get to me, honestly. And, you know, sometimes there are organizations out there that are still very male-driven or only accept males, and I laugh about it and just realize that, you know, I'm in a better place.
Yeah,
so.
Absolutely.
For yeah. sure.
Cool. So, okay. Out of all these sports, I mean, was there any place that you went to that you were like, I don't necessarily enjoy that sport as much? Or do you just love all of them? I mean, you went from hockey to basketball to golf.
Well, I loved hockey. Hockey is so fun, especially minor league hockey, because, man, they just go at it.
Yeah.
And it's pretty exciting. Basketball was great. I've always been a huge basketball fan. And going on the female side of basketball as well, it's just really good fundamental basketball.
Mm-hmm.
The Falcons was really exciting. It was the first time. It was right when Arthur Blank bought the team. So a huge wholesale shift with pricing. The first time that they beat Green Bay at Green Bay in a playoff game. You know, so that was really exciting. Going to, like I said, female sports was really fun. Fundamental basketball and the way that they work within the community is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
NASCAR, that was a different shift for me because it was one event compared to multiple events through the team side. And honestly, I enjoy that much more because it gives you a little bit more of a work-life balance.
Mm-hmm.
You're not working a ton of games. You're working and focusing on, you know, one or two events throughout the year. So that is been very helpful for me to actually have a family and a life outside of work, and I've got two little girls, so
mm-hmm.
it's important for me to be with them.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with golf.
Right.
I love the PGA Tour. The PGA Tour is a fantastic organization, really is heavily focused on diversity and inclusion. Jay Monahan, our new commissioner, well, he was new in 2017, has been fabulous for us, really changed the way we think, turning the camera on the fans, not just on the players, really incorporating the experience into the events. We can have phones now. I mean, you can actually see what happens at a PGA Tour event. So every single sport has shaped who I am.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't say that there's one that I would say that is just the best or just not as good. Everything has really helped me grow to the person I am right now.
Yeah. Okay, so I have to admit that I'm not a huge golfer.
But
I have a couple girlfriends that are, Carol Ann and Allison, and so I text them, I was like, hey, what type of questions like would real golfers actually want to know about? So one of the questions that they had said was, who is a golfer that you think is one to watch?
One to watch, Tiger, honestly. Tiger Woods has been phenomenal for the game. You know, he started this phenomenon of these young kids wanting to golf, and now you're actually seeing it in his competition. I mean, he created Jordan Spieth. He created Justin Thomas, Ricky Fowler, and now these guys are actually playing against him. So it's all come full circle for him. So
right.
I think he's ultimately just amazing person for the game. But there's some great golfers out there right now, like Bryson DeChambeau. He won two of the playoff events last year. You've got Phil, who's still playing, who won last weekend. So
the great thing about the PGA Tour is that you rarely get people that are win consistently every single week. So it's typically someone different. Mm-hmm. And it's really exciting to watch these young kids get out there and play. They're just a completely different type of golfer than some of the past generations.
So. What makes them different, the new generation?
You know, for example, Ricky Fowler, they've grown up over social media. Mm-hmm. So it's really fun to watch these guys because a lot of golf is very competitive, but these guys are really good friends. So you'll see on their social channels, like outside of golf, you know, they'll be hanging out at each other's houses. They'll be going on trips together. They'll be going on dates together. So it's really fun to watch them interact. And some of these guys, they're just great in the community. Mm. They understand what it means and what it means to do what they do and how important they are in the grand scheme of things and how important they are to kids these days.
Yeah.
And the type of sport they play and how they can actually grow these young kids to want to become golfers just like them. Mm-hmm. So it's been a lot of fun to watch these guys really interact with a crowd. They're some of the nicest kids on the tour, honestly. So it's neat to watch right now. And I think the average age last year of the tour championship, Phil brought it up a little bit. it's like 28 or 29. So they're very young. And to be this young, making that much money and just have a great head on their shoulders, It's nice to watch compared to some other sports.
Yeah. And with all those types of changes, even with the different type of golfers that are coming up, are there any types of changes to the tour that you're making?
There's a lot of changes, actually. This year, the tour has really changed the schedule, moving some of the biggest events. So the Players' Championship, which was typically in May, moves down to March. March, and then you've got the Masters in April. You've got the PGA Championship move from August to May. Then you've got the U.S. Open in June, the Open in July, and then all of the playoff events are moving to August. So now you've got golf's biggest events aligned to really create an amazing schedule for the partners, for the fans, and for the golfers.
Yeah.
So you've got a pretty exciting event every single month leading up to the Tour Championship, which is at the end of August, August 21st to the 25th.
And why that change? Is it just to kind of build that momentum with the fans?
It's to build the momentum with the fans. It's to make it easier for people to get out to the events. But also, we end before a lot of big sporting events start. So we generally have the opportunity to own the month of August. Mm. Last year, when we were in season and the Tour Championship was playing in September, there were over 300,000 paid sporting event tickets out in the marketplace.
Wow.
This year, it's just the Tour Championship. We've got no Braves are in town. Atlanta United's not in town. No college football. No professional football. It's the place to be. It's going to be very exciting.
That's so smart.
Mm-hmm.
Was that your decision?
Not my decision. No, that's been going on for a while prior to me even getting here. So.
That's so smart. Another change that's happening, again, according to my friend, is the point system. So there's big changes, right, coming for the point system?
Big changes, yes. And it's just for the Tour Championship.
Okay.
So previously, if you wanted to look at the leaderboard and understand where people were to try and win the FedEx Cup, it was really confusing. The point system was all over the place. Mm-hmm. We also had two winners for the Tour Championship. So you had a Tour Championship winner and you had a FedEx Cup winner, potentially. There were a couple times when there was only one winner, but last year, a perfect example, Tiger won the tournament and Justin Rose won the FedEx Cup. Mm-hmm. So this way it makes it super easy. When you get to Eastlake, the points are set at, the top person is set at 10 under. Then it goes to 8 under, 7 under, 6 under, 5 under. And then it just basically every five golfers start a point down.
Okay.
So it's really easy. You look at the leaderboard, you know exactly where you are in terms of who's winning the FedEx Cup. So, you know, someone could walk